You're the king of my life. You're the king of my life. You reign above it all. You reign above it all. Over the universe and over every heart, there is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all. On the cross, the world
in the land we live in. And I'm living in. generation. Look at what the Lord has done. Sing it to the darkness that the light has come. Well, sing it to the nations. Oh, look at what the Lord. Sing it again. Sing it to the daughters. Sing it to the sons. To every generation. Look at what the Lord. As I bow before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, your mankind living in. So no matter where I go, and no matter.
Welcome to church. So good to be together this morning. Let's stand to our feet. We're going to worship our King Jesus. Let me just read this from Isaiah 12. It says this: thank the Lord, praise his name, tell the nations what he has done. Let them know how mighty he is. Sing to the Lord, for he has done wonderful things. Make known his praise around the world. Let me pray before we sing. Lord, we are here for you this morning. We are here to give you praise and honor, to lift you high. So Lord, by your Holy Spirit, meet with us now. Clear our minds of distractions, Lord. Instead, be ever present, be so magnified in our minds. And Lord, may we respond by lifting our voices to you in Jesus' name. Let's sing.
Voice. Oh, praise the
third.
In on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again.
Oh, trample,
oh, trample down. Where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, trample down. Where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, 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 praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh Lord our God. And oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh Lord our God. Oh Lord, oh Lord.
A shout of praise to Him this morning. So worthy. Come on, let's continue to worship.
Him, who place their hope and confidence in Jesus. He won't forsake it. Blessed are those who seek His face, who bend their knee and fix their gaze on Jesus. They won't be shaken. Come on and fields of plenty. Bless God in the darkest valley. Every chance I get, I bless Your name. Bless God when my hands are empty. Bless God with
the praise that caused me. Bless God when nobody's watching, every chance I get. Come on, let's sing it again. Bless God when the weapon's falling. Bless God when the walls are falling. Bless God cause he goes before me, every chance I get. We bless your name.
Worthy God, worthy of everything, of every breath, worthy of our lives. Lord, we lay our lives down to you. There is no one who compares to you, King Jesus. You are great, you are mighty, you are powerful, you are sovereign. Oh God, we praise you this morning. Sing of how good you are.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. And our great is our God. Say with me, how great is our God, and oh, say. Oh, how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The God three in one, his Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. And how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. How great
We just sit in this moment, and even in your heart and your mind, where you stand there this morning, just recognize and receive how great God is. Maybe in your heart you want to tell God how great He is, but recognize now that there's a God who loves you, a God who cares for you, a God who is gracious towards you, a God who is for you, and a God who is in control, a God who is working out His plans and purposes in your life and through your life, a God who has revealed Himself in Jesus, a God that can be known, a God that can be trusted, a God that you can walk with every day of your life. And so, God, we lift You up in this place. We recognize right now Your presence with us. And God, it is our delight to lift You up. May You become greater and may we become less. The greater that we lift You up, the safer we are, the more life we experience as we lift You up into that highest place. That's our desire, God. So be lifted up, be worshipped here. And I pray each one might know a very special sense of the reality of Your presence with us here today. We praise You and worship You. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Can we put our hands together and give more praise to our great God? He's worthy of our praise, and it's just so good to see you all here this morning. We want to be a church that just welcomes one another, encourages one another. I said to someone this morning, we're not meant to do life alone. We know God, but we're not meant to do it alone. We need community, and that's where it's really important to welcome and encourage one another. I'm going to ask you to do that in just a moment. I also want to welcome those online. We're back online at the 10 a.m. service. Say hello to Helen, your host there. For families this morning, we don't have the usual kids programs, but you can get a booklet from the back. If you've got younger ones and you want to make use of the creche, it's open. You can take your kids to the creche there. And for families next week, just a one-off is a family service on the 21st over in A2 as well. Well, let's do a good job welcoming one another. Just take the time just to welcome those around you. That'd be amazing. Thank you. Great job, church. We can continue that in the courtyard. This morning is a very special morning in that we get to commission a team to head across to Cambodia to work with Sandra Perry, who has a long-term ministry there that many of you are quite familiar with. Before me is Pastor Dan and the interns from this year. I just wanted to shine a bit of a light on the internship program we have in the church. These guys, we've spent time with them doing sessions. They've served here in the church, grown. And I just wanted to firstly thank the interns. You've invested a year and we loved hanging out with you, loved seeing God work in your life. So can we really thank the interns from last year? And their experience is culminating with this trip across to Cambodia. But I thought I'd just ask Dan a quick question, what he's seen God do in the internship over the last year, but also what he's looking forward to in Cambodia.
Yeah, I have a pitch for these guys at the beginning of the year. The internship is really just this. If you want to come together, you want to see God, you want to see Him work in your life, then how about we just come together with other people who want to do the very same thing and see what God does. Just create that open space for Him to speak to you and lead you in your current context. And for each one of these guys, I truly have to say, there's two that are not on the stage here today, but my heart, seeing God being revealed in them and through them has been such a blessing to me, but to many around them. And it's been a great opportunity to see in their individual context, how God has been unfolding that reality, them putting their faith in Him and Him proving to be faithful in their lives. That's been an incredible journey for me, an exciting thing for me to see. And just as they've put their faith in God so tangibly in their specific context, in their routine every day, being able to go to Cambodia with Sandy and see the Hodges there as well is an opportunity to see God being faithful again in a different context, what their routine, outside of their normal routines. And so I'm really excited. And it's just an awesome opportunity to see how God works through people who are faithful to Him, through Sandy, the Hodges there. We're just very excited to be able to be a part of that.
And we're very thankful for Pastor Dan for his heart in investing in this crew, but just serving us widely in the church, leading this team, and his heart for missions there as well. And we're very thankful for you, Sandy, who's worked across in Cambodia for many years in prisons and orphanages and brings a whole lot of experience. We're so glad that this team can learn from you and experience your ministry over there. Can you tell us a little bit about what this team might be doing when they get over there in Cambodia?
Yeah, thanks, Andrew. Thank you for your support, everyone. First of all, it'll be a new culture for them. They'll find out how it feels to be in a totally opposite culture, which is a non-Christian culture. But we will be going, so seeing prisoners, there are over 30,000 young men in prison and women in prison in that country. And just seeing, getting a feel of what it's like and thinking about how God can use them in the perfect plan He's got for each one, is this world needs them. And we'll be going, so we'll be working alongside the prisoners in their garden, pulling some weeds out and talking with them as best they can. And teaching the ladies about makeup, just little simple things like that. And also we'll be going to the slum, because that's where a great work is being done among the poor through this church. And they will be attending a teen Bible study. So good for these young teenagers in the slum to see Westerners come and believe that the same that they're being taught. And we'll be giving out food to the poor. We'll be looking at how people live in poverty and just getting a heart for God, how He sees the imprisoned and the poor and for their future days. And it's going to be really good, and I'm glad they're coming. Thanks very much.
Amen. Yeah. Before we pray, though, I just want to share this verse for you as a team. Jesus said to us as His followers, "You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." That will be our prayer for you. And I just imagine you here you are, you've come from the West, you're weeding gardens in a prison. As those prisoners, what are they going to think? There's going to be a light that's shining. As you serve one another, as you love one another, as you go to a slum and teach young people scriptures, let your light shine, that people will see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Would you join me as we pray for this team? Lord Jesus, that's a call for all of us, but a call specifically for this team in this context. And Lord Jesus, we pray your light would shine so brilliantly and so brightly in the prison, in the slums, as they go to a market, wherever they are, Lord, people would see there's something different about this team. There's a love that's within them. There's a different character that is within them. And they would that would lead them to question or wonder or to see you and to bring glory to you. And so, Lord, we pray that your light would shine. I want to thank you for Dan. Thank you for his leadership. Thank you for his heart to serve and love in the internship, but also in this program. Would you bless him? Would you bless Sandra? We thank you so much for many, many years of shining light in these places. Lord, would you bless her as she leads the team as well, as she goes before them. And Lord, we want to pray for your spirit to unite this team and use them for your glory. We pray and look forward to the stories that will be shared. Thank you, God, that they can rest on your faithfulness, on your presence, on your character as they do this. And any moment where they feel like they're walking on water, may their eyes be fixed on you, I pray. And so bless them, protect them, and fill them. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Could you thank the team for us here this morning? It's an exciting time of year. I hope you've had a great break and you're feeling rested and getting to get into the year. We've got some great things coming up. And the first thing I wanted to mention is Alpha. Many of you came to Christmas lights and the Christmas services, and we've put out the invitation for people to join us to do Alpha. And there are a number of opportunities for that. For our online viewers, on Tuesday this week, there's an online Alpha happening. But also for those here, you might have friends that might more easily connect in and do Alpha online. We've seen wonderful results through online Alpha. And so you might have friends you can share those details with. We're really encouraging people to come along to Alpha. Also in February, let me just get the dates for you. On the 11th and 13th of February, we have Alpha here at church. And also in a local cafe, Cubby House Coffee. It's going to be set up in a really unique way just to welcome our guests and to do Alpha in the cafe there as well. And our experience of Alpha is that when people are brought with a friend, if you've got a friend that you want to invite, maybe just ask them, would you like me to come with you? And when it's a big hurdle for people to come, but if someone is willing to come with them, it makes it much more comfortable. And it's been amazing to see how God's used the power of an invitation. We've heard it many times in baptism stories here. So let's all pray and think of who we can be inviting to Alpha. All the details are in your newsletter. Also, at the start of the year, we love doing a church-wide series where the sermons and our midweek small group material all matches up for 4 weeks. And we're encouraging everyone part of this church to join in for that church-wide series starting on the 18th of February. We're starting that series on prayer. Prayer is one of our greatest gifts, that we can talk to the Creator, and we want to make prayer simple. It's a simple conversation with God, but so powerful. Where there's much prayer, there is much power. So I want to encourage you to join in a church-wide series, small group there. There'll be Families Connect for families during that time as well. Also, Inspire starts on the 7th of February, our midweek service on a Wednesday morning there. Just one typo in this week's newsletter. It mentioned that the 4 p.m. Service was starting next week, but it's actually starting on the 28th. So another week, and 28th, that is starting, just to make mention of that. RI training is on the 30th of January. If you're considering that, praying into that, come and just get trained to get more information. We love having people in our schools just sharing God's word there as well. And also finally, just a massive thank you to our Bridge Care team. If you go to the top property, we've got our Bridge Care shed, but the team there in the last week or two have been concreting all the paths around. A massive job, but done a wonderful job doing that. And I'd love if we can just thank that team for all their hard work. Not easy. Not easy concreting in the hot summer weather. And there's such a great bunch that have got a heart to serve. And I stood in that shed and thought, God, how many lives are going to be blessed through all that happens in and through this ministry in that new facility there as well. So really thankful for that team. I did want to, just before I pray, just extend sympathy to Jenny Thomas. She might be in this service somewhere, Jenny. Jenny, we just want to share our sympathy with you in the passing of your mother, and we'll be praying with you in this season. We're so glad you could be with us here this morning, but just praying with you as well. And I'd love just to pray for others that are unwell at the moment too. Would you join me as we pray? Lord, I want to thank you that you are a God of all seasons, and particularly think of Jenny and her family, Lord, that they might know you as their comforter, as their strength, might know your love and your presence with them at this time. And Lord, I just think of those that are unwell at the moment and just pray for your healing touch over their lives. I think of Rita and Merv. I think of those having treatment at the moment, Nairi, Karen, Phil and Zephora. May God, your healing hand be upon them and you be strengthening them, and the love of God through your people and through the presence of the Holy Spirit be with them. We pray for Lorraine, Lord, for her operation this week. Would you bless that operation? God, may it be fully effective. We think of Bucky, Lord God. We pray your blessing upon him. Bless the whole family. Give a real sense of peace, Lord, as he's cared for there. And we think of young Ailish in New Zealand, God. Would your healing touch be on her life? Would you take the infection, Lord God, and give a peace to mum and dad there in New Zealand as well? And Father, we also just thank you that you're a God who speaks. There's something special, Lord, as we open our hearts to you, that, Lord, you speak. And now as John comes to bring your word to us, Lord, may we have that heart that is like, Lord, here I am. I'm listening. I'm ready to respond. And so, Lord, speak to us as he comes to share. May you speak through your Holy Spirit, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're really glad to have Dr. Reverend John Sweetman here. For those that have been at Bridgeman for a long time, you would have known John Spoken. If you're newer to Bridgeman, John is actually Pastor Peter's brother. He was the principal of Malian College when a lot of us as pastors went through, and now is coordinating the regional ministers of the denomination. So we're really glad to have John and his wife Debbie here today as well. So could you please welcome John as he comes to share. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Andrew. I love the way the music swells. It makes you feel like something special is going to happen. I'm very sorry to disappoint you, but love the fact that you're doing another series on prayer, just the beautiful heart of this church. And if you're new around the place, you've got to get into one of those groups and study what prayer can do. My whole theology, understanding of vision and faith and prayer has very much been modeled in this church. I've come to see that this is the way God can do, loves to do things, and so make sure you get involved in that. When it comes to motivation, there's two very basic ways of motivating people. One is the carrot and the other is the stick. The carrot is offering people incentives, rewards for doing whatever needs to be done, and the stick is threatening punishments if they don't do what needs to be done. And both the carrot and the stick are important in motivating people to do, and not just people, but animals. Because we've got a little dog at our place when we're in Brisbane. Our son and daughter-in-law have got a little puppy, a brand new puppy called Willow, and she's wild. Like, she just loves chewing the carpets and jumping up and down. She loves life and she loves people, and so she has to be trained. And so they're using partly the carrot thing, you know, so not real carrots, but, you know, they got all these little doggy treats that she loves. And so if she sits down or whatever she's supposed to do, they give her a treat, and that's the carrot. And then they also use the stick, not literally, but when she doesn't do what she's told, she has to go into puppy timeout. I don't know if you've ever heard of puppy timeout. I never had. But she has to go into the laundry and they leave her in there for 30 seconds, you know, and she learns that. Anyway, it is working. It's slowly, but it is working. And she's she's gradually being trained and settling down. Some people think that in preaching, we use too much stick and not enough carrot. And there could be some truth in that. It's easy to say these are the dangers, and the difficulty with that is, I mean, there's a place for it. Certainly there's a place for it. And certain times in history, it's been really emphasized very strongly. The difficulty is that people end up feeling very guilty as a result of that. And thinking of Michelangelo's The Last Judgment painting, you know, and demons carrying people off to hell and all the rest, you know. And so it is easy for Christians to get a real sense of guilt that they're not good enough, that they'll never be good enough for God, that God will never accept them, or they can never do enough to please God. So this morning we're going to have a look at a passage that has got both carrot and stick things in it. And I'm going to try, a little bit against my nature, but I'm going to try and be carrot this morning, all right? So I'm going to try and tell you the reasons why, the blessings that will come if you do what God wants. So if you leave this morning feeling guilty, that's your problem, right? Not the problem of the preacher. Well, let's have a look at the passage. It's Matthew 6, 19 to 21. It's just a nice short passage. Jesus said this, "Don't store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moths and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moths and vermin do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Now, before I look at this scripture, I just want to say something about grace. Grace is the foundation of Christian faith, right? It makes Christianity different from any other religion, any other cause. It says that we are not good enough and we don't have to be good enough. It says that God loves us intensely despite our brokenness and despite our weakness, that God is incredibly interested in us. That this morning before you got up, he's been thinking about you. The God of the universe that we've been singing about this morning has been thinking about you. He loves you. He wants the best for you. He wants to pour out his grace on you and give you peace and love and joy and a future and a purpose. All of these things is what God... And we don't have to do anything to deserve that. Okay, this is what God loves to do. This is what God wants to do for you. This is very important for us to understand as our foundation. Before we look at this passage, it doesn't seem to have too much grace in it. All right, well, it's important to get this foundation of grace there, you know. It's hard for us to imagine a God that would love us so greatly despite all that we've done. Probably the closest taste we get of it is in family. We've been away on holidays for a fair while up in Caloundra. I don't know what holidays is when you're retired, but anyway, we've been away at Caloundra and all the rest. And we've had grandkids up there with us. And the other day I decided I would go for a walk on the beach, which I love to do. And the grandkids were sitting around, you know, and I just said to anyone who would listen, I said, I'm going to go for a walk on the beach. And little Joey, who's four, very cute four, said, "Oh, Grandpa, would you like someone to go with you?" And I said, "Oh, Joey, that would be lovely." He said, "Oh, not me." But despite that, despite the rejection, I just love that little guy. I really do, you know. And that's what God's like with you. And he just loves you. He just wants so much to pour out his grace and his blessing on your life forever. That's what grace is all about. But this scripture doesn't sound much like grace, does it? If this is our foundation, how does this scripture fit in? Let me just read it to you again. "Don't store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moths and vermin destroy, but where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moths and vermin do not destroy and where thieves don't break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." We all know what storing up treasure on earth is about, because we've all done it. Most of us have super funds, for example, or have had super funds, and we watch those occasionally, maybe, as they increase, or if we're retired like I am, decrease, but you watch your super carefully. That's storing up treasure on earth, and that's fine. We all need to do that. We know what that is about. Of course, when Jesus is talking about treasure on earth, he's not just talking about money, although money and prosperity is one element of it, but it's also all the things that make us feel significant and make life enjoyable for us on earth, you know. So it might be our careers, or it might be our holidays, or whatever it might be. Someone that came up to me after the first service said, "You've told me I can't do my overseas trip." I said, no, I didn't say that. I didn't say that. We're going overseas ourselves in a few months' time. So it's not that we can't do those things. Because we all do. There's a lot in this world that we're involved with, and we're storing up treasures on earth. Of course, some people have more treasure than others, and it's easy to read a passage like this and think, well, this is for the really rich people, you know. We don't really have all that much, you know, but of course, most of the people Jesus is talking to did not have much money at all. They were subsistence farmers. Like, they were just getting by day by day, week by week. And so what Jesus is saying is not for rich people or just for rich people. It certainly applies to rich people, but it applies to all of us. He says, don't make this earth the place that you store most of your treasures up. So treasures in heaven, what are treasures in heaven then? If we understand what treasures in earth are, what are treasures in heaven? Well, it's easy to think of treasures in heaven as being kind of the really big spiritual things that we do, you know. So the team's going to Cambodia, you know, like that's storing up treasure in heaven. And it certainly is. This is doing what God wants. This is serving people the way God wants. And so it's easy to think, you know, maybe this is like the pastors do a lot of storing up treasure in heaven, you know. And it's the big stuff we do when we make big choices for God, when we make large sacrifices. That's what storing up treasure in heaven is about. But it's actually not really. I mean, those things are included. But storing up treasure in heaven is just when we say, God, I want to serve you and I want to serve people. Jesus gives plenty of examples of storing up treasure in heaven. Let me give you just one example that Jesus gives. This is in Matthew 25. Then the king will say to those on his right, come you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me. You see, they're the kind of actions that are involved in storing up treasure in heaven. As we do serve people, small things that you've done, you've come to church this morning, right? That's a sacrifice to a degree. And that's part of storing up treasure in heaven. That's God says, I'm really pleased with that. You've served someone this week. You've forgiven someone this week. You've been in the middle of your job and you've thought, what on earth am I doing here? And then you say, God, I want you to use me here. I want to be your servant here in this place. That's storing up treasure in heaven. Can you see that? So it's not just the big stuff that we imagine, well, God will remember that, or other people will remember that. It's a whole lot of accumulation of little stuff that we do day after day after day that means we're storing up treasure in heaven. Now, I need to make it really clear that this storing up treasure in heaven has got nothing to do with our salvation, right? Our salvation is based on grace. You can know that you're going to heaven to be with God forever, not because of anything you've done, but because of what Jesus has done for you. And if you're not a Christian yet, then that's what you need to focus. You can listen to what I have to say about this passage, but your main focus is to receive the love of God. You've so far lived without God, and that hurts God, but he still loves you. And he's reaching out with open arms this morning and saying, I want you to be my child forever. And that's his grace. So this storing up treasure has nothing to do with will you be good enough to get to heaven, or nothing to do with that. That's based on grace. But if you are a Christian, what happens is as you receive the grace of God, it makes a difference to the way you live. And so this storing up treasure for in heaven is a key thing for those of us that belong to Jesus. And I could look at this and talk about, you know, how we spend too much time doing stuff on earth and we're too involved and too committed and it takes up too much of our life. And that would be like the sticks sort of thing. And I kind of naturally go there in some ways. But I'll say that because the passage says a little bit. But I want to focus today on the carrot stuff, all right? So why should you store up treasure in heaven? Like, what motivation do you have? What are the good stuff that will happen as you store up treasure in heaven? So I want to look at it from a stick, not from a carrot perspective, all right? And try and stick to that as much as I can. All right, so I've got two good reasons, right? That Jesus says in this passage, why you need to be storing treasure in heaven. Why it's a great thing. Why it's a blessing to store treasure in heaven. All right, so here they are. The first one is this. Treasure in heaven counts forever. I don't know that moths and vermin are too much of a problem for our treasures on earth, although I do have a couple of T-shirts that have got moth holes in them now. I thought that might make me look more cool, you know, having holes, but anyway. But certainly we know what thieves are like. Most of us are very aware of that now because of all the scams that are going on. Every time you read in the newspaper, there's this another story about someone who's been scammed out of their life savings. They've lost everything to a scammer. So we know what that's like. And we know that the nature of what we store on earth could disappear at any time. And that's a healthy thing because that's true. There was a popular bumper sticker in the 1980s and that said, "He who dies with the most toys wins." Someone after the service in the morning said, there was a one that came after that that said, "He who dies with the most toys still dies." But that's the way most people in our world think, you know, that somehow if we can accumulate enough, if we can get enough credibility, if we can get enough respect, if we can get enough pleasure and enjoyment, then we've won. And of course, that's just not the truth. Job said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, I came with nothing, and naked I will depart. When I leave, I take nothing with me." I remember when my dad was dying. Dad was a beautiful man, served in this church and many other places as well, and was a business leader and all the rest as well. And I watched this man that had achieved so much and done so much. And next to him in the bed, also dying, was a guy who was an alcoholic and had wasted his life and alienated all his family and all the rest. And yet as they died together, I could see that really, materially, the end of the life is the same for everyone. It's the same no matter what you achieved, no matter what you've done, no matter how much respect that you have earned. The fact is we take nothing. We take nothing out of this world. I've got a joke, all right? So let me tell a joke now. Now, I don't usually tell jokes in sermons, but I thought a little bit of light relief might be good. And I just want to point out this is not good theology, all right? So just in case anyone gets confused, right? There's this guy that decided, he was very wealthy and decided he would take his wealth to heaven and God would be blessed by his wealth. So he knocked on the door of heaven, whatever they say in these jokes. And St. Peter said yes. And he said, "Well, look, I'm here." But what he'd done is he'd converted all that he owned into gold. And so he'd put it all in suitcases and brought it all with him. All the stacks of gold, you know what I mean? And he said, "I'm here." And St. Peter said, "Well, why should you come here?" Well, he said, "I've got so much to offer. I've brought all of this stuff with me. And I want to use it here." And St. Peter said, "Oh, look, I appreciate your effort in bringing all that, but why did you spend so much effort bringing road pavers? Now, that's a little in-joke, all right. It's a dad joke, really. Streets in heaven line with gold. That's the, you know, that's if you need an explanation of it. But it is true, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? Like, all that we think's important here won't matter one little bit when it comes to standing before God. Nothing will count. You can say, well, I've made all this stuff and I've done all these things and I've achieved everything, and it makes no difference. It makes no difference. Naked, we come into this world, and naked we go out. We take nothing with us. We take nothing with us. So Jesus says, you know, like, you can build that treasure in heaven, and like, we enjoy some of those things, and some of those things are a blessing. I'm not saying some of those things are a gift from God that we have. I'm not saying in any way that we shouldn't enjoy some of the things that God pours out in our life. It's just that it's not going to last, right? That stuff's not going to last. But Jesus did say, on the other hand, treasure in heaven is eternal. It lasts forever. But store up, verse 20, but store up for yourself treasures in heaven where moth and vermin don't destroy and where thieves don't break in and steal. In other words, he's saying, when we store up treasure in heaven, nothing touches it. Nothing takes it away. It's there forever. I've got a really poor memory, and people occasionally come up to me and say, John, you know, 30 years ago, you said this to me and it was very significant for me. And I can't remember, of course, saying that, and I can't usually remember who they even are, but I think, wow, I used to be really wise, didn't I, you know? But it is a great encouragement to think that someone's remembered something that I've said. Something that I've done or said has made a difference in someone's life. So you take that little bit, you multiply that by millions and millions and millions, and you've got your life in heaven. It's your life. All of those things you've done, every single thing that you've done for Jesus will count forever, will be remembered forever. And the little stuff, do you know what I mean? Like the many, many things that you've done that no one's noticed and you've long forgotten about them. God will say, hey, remember when you did this? That was such a blessing. Oh, I'm so pleased about that. And other people will say, hey, remember when you asked us over for dinner? Or remember when you prayed with me? And you'll say, no, I don't remember. Maybe my memory will be better and your memory will be better in heaven. I don't know. And you go, you know, wow, that was fantastic. You see, everything you do that makes a difference for God, that serves others, and that's in workplaces as well and in families, and you don't have to have church work to be doing stuff in heaven, right? It's everything. It all counts. It counts forever. Now, that's a good investment, isn't it? I guess we've got financial advisors here. Like, that's a good investment. If you can invest something in things that are going to last forever and ever and ever and be remembered by God and others forever and ever, like, that's a good investment. So that's the first carrot. We invest in treasure in heaven because, well, everything else is going, but that's lasting forever. The second reason is, and this is a little bit more complicated, so let me see if I can try to explain it. But it comes from verse 21 where Jesus says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Okay, so he distinguishes between treasure and heart. Your heart is what motivates you. Do you know what I mean? It's what you really think and feel deep down inside you. This is your heart, the desires that you have deep down inside you. Your treasure is your priorities. The things that are most important to you, the things that you are doing that you feel need to be done, all right? So that's your treasure and that's your heart. Now, normally we would think treasure follows heart. In other words, as you get your heart right with God, you know what it's like to live with God, you listen to God, and then that changes what you do. That changes the way you behave. That changes what your treasure is, the things, your priorities in life as your heart gets right with God. And that's true, all right? I'm not denying that. That is absolutely true. It's just not what Jesus says here. What does he say? For where, he doesn't say where your heart is, that's where your treasure will be. He says where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be. In other words, he says your heart follows your treasure. And I think that's important for us to understand as well. It's certainly true that treasure follows heart, but it's also true that often heart follows treasure. Let me try and illustrate that. When I was younger, I went out teaching in the country and I got myself a motorbike. It was a trail bike and got a couple of them and we used to have fantastic fun. And then when I came to Brisbane, I continued to ride my motorbike. And I loved riding the motorbike. And those of you that have never been on a motorbike will not know the freedom that you feel, the smells, all that you see. Do you know what I mean? It's just a different experience from driving in a car. And I loved it. So I rode around the place. We had a car as well, but I used the bike when I could and rode around the place for about 10 years or so and loved every moment. My heart was riding bikes. I love that. Then we found out that we were going to have a baby, and so I had to rethink my priorities. Now, I had nothing against riding motorbikes, right? Okay. If you want to be temporary Australian, that's up to you, all right? I know many of my mates ride bikes. They've gone back into riding bikes now and all the rest, you know. But I kind of thought, I love riding and I don't want to give this up. But my priority is this little baby that's coming. And so I want to make sure that I do everything to stay alive and stay healthy for this little boy. And I'm going to stop riding my motorbike. Now, I'm not saying that's everyone should do that. That was just a personal decision I made, pushed a lot by my wife, but it was my decision. And my heart, I still love riding bikes. I still did. Do you know what I mean? But my priorities, my treasure, was this little baby coming. And so I made a call. I didn't want to do it, but I made a call because I knew that it was the right thing to do. And my heart eventually followed along. So as it went on, I didn't ride my bike. I lost my desire, my heart for riding bikes. And I'm still the same way. You know, like, as I said, I've got mates that have got bikes and they say, you know, aren't you going to get your big Harley or whatever you want to get? And I say, I'm not interested in that. I've got an electric scooter and I wear a full face helmet when I ride it. Peter doesn't even like me doing that. So eventually my heart followed my priorities, my treasure. And that's what Jesus is saying here, that what will happen is that if you get your priorities right, sometimes it's just hard work, you know. Coming along to the prayer meeting when you don't feel like it, or being nice to someone at work when they're being awful to you. Or, do you know what I mean? Like, all those things multiply. Sometimes it's just making a choice and saying, my treasure is with Jesus. And I know that this is what he wants. I don't feel it. I don't particularly want to do this, but this is what I'm going to do. And your heart eventually will follow along. It'll change your heart towards Jesus. So some of you are sitting here this morning saying, I just wish I had a heart for Jesus, you know, and that's great. Do you know what I mean? And maybe God will do that in you as you seek him and all the rest. But maybe it's just getting your priorities right, getting your treasure in the right place, and then your heart's going to follow along. It's going to love those things eventually, even if it's hard work at the start. Does that make sense? Have I explained that well enough? Jesus said, where your treasure is, the things that are important and priorities for you, that's where your heart will be also. So in other words, you can sit here this morning saying, I love Jesus. I really want to serve him. I really want to please him. I love the worship and all the rest. But if this week, you find yourself just doing the stuff, building treasure on earth that everyone else is doing. You hardly think of Jesus. You're working hard, you're enjoying your life, whatever it might be, and that's as much as it happens in your life. If that's the case, then your heart's going to be there eventually. You might say, oh, well, I love Jesus, but it's just that this is my life. No. Eventually your heart will be. And I'm sure you've seen too, so many people. Hearts have got dragged away by their treasure. Have you seen that? these things that they value, these priorities that they have, grabs them, and then eventually the heart gets carried away too. So, hopefully, the carrot then this morning, right? So why build up treasure in heaven? Why not invest? Why not have a good time on earth, which we do anyway? Do you know what I mean? But why not make that my priority? Why not do that? One is, you're not building up stuff that'll last forever. You can, this week, do things that are going to be remembered forever and ever and ever by God and by your friends and by you as well. Things that God will celebrate forever. So you can do that. What a wonderful opportunity. And the second thing is that as you do that, you'll find that your heart changes and your heart will get drawn to what really is important for you. And that'll make a huge difference for you as you seek to serve Jesus. So why store up treasure in heaven? It lasts forever. That's a great investment and it'll change your heart. This doesn't mean that we don't care about practical issues. You know, you can go on your cruises and all the rest. You know what I mean? It's not that this has to be all that we do. Do you know what I mean? God, in His graciousness, gives us many good things. We enjoy our family and we enjoy some of the resources that God gives us. All of those things are good. They're just not most important, that's all. They're just not to be relied on. They're just not to dominate our lives. Storing up treasure for heaven. In heaven, that's where it's at. Now, just a final thing I need to say, that for this to work, to really store up treasure in heaven, you need to really believe that you're going to live forever with God. Now, I don't just mean theoretically. Of course, we all believe that death's not the end. I mean, very, very few of us here this morning would say, well, once you die, that's it, nothing after that. Most of us, particularly if you had someone you love die, most of us would say, no, there's more than that. Of course, there's more than that, you know. But what I'm saying is really believe it, like really believe it, that this is what counts, that we're here for this short period of time, but we've got a whole future that's going to be fabulous. There's a guy called Michael Bird. He's an Aussie theologian, New Testament scholar, brilliant guy, Melian College graduate, may I say. So we've got Andrew and Michael Bird. and he's just written a book with N.T. Wright, who's a very famous New Testament exegete. And it's about early Christianity. What were the Christians like in the early church? And someone asked Michael, What's the major difference? What is the big difference that you see between, now you know so much about Christians in the early church, and Christians today? And Mike said, the biggest difference I can see is that in the early church, they really believed that Jesus was about to return. And that radically transformed the way they thought and what they did. Now, I know it's been 2,000 years and I know it's easy for us to lose that heart and that passion, but the fact is, it is happening. It is happening. There is an end to this world. There is justice. God will prevail. And there will come a time when He said, enough is enough. And if we believe that, then storing up treasure in heaven really becomes more significant for us. If we don't believe that, it's hard for us to get out the trap of this world and what it forces us into its mould. Okay, that's enough for today. I'm just checking. Anyone feel guilty here, right? Just checking. Oh, there's a few that are still feeling guilty. I'm sorry about that. Someone said to me after the service, every time you come, I always feel so guilty. I said, thanks a lot. Let me pray, hey? Well, Jesus, to think that, Lord, we thank You for Your grace. We celebrate that, Lord, that we're going to live forever with You if we're Your children. And that's incredible. Nothing we have to do to earn it. Doesn't matter what we do or where we've been, Lord Jesus, that Your grace reaches out to us. And we thank You so much for that. But Lord, we can make a difference. We really can. We can do things significant in this earth, on this earth. It's not just a matter of waiting till You return. We can make a difference this week. We can do stuff that is going to be remembered and celebrated forever. We can do stuff that's going to draw our hearts away from this world and towards you and your priorities and your agenda and your grace and your love, Lord. And so we thank you for that. We're not just marking time here. We're not just wasting our time. We're investing in something, Lord, in your kingdom that's going to last forever, be remembered forever, Lord. So help us, encourage us, motivate us, strengthen us, Lord. May we make a difference this week. We pray in your name. Amen.
Thanks, John. I was listening there and thinking that the Christian life in following Jesus is one of incredible purpose, isn't it? That we can live with eternal perspective. We can make a difference eternally in him. That his kingdom is coming in and through us in this world. And that we live a life orientating around this sense that there's treasure in heaven. There's a life beyond this life. And that can be done in the simplest way, as John said. You go into your workplace, bring his kingdom into the workplace. Love, serve, care in that place, in your family. The simplest of acts. I love that verse. It says, what you did for the least of these, you actually did for me, Jesus says. What an incredible thought. That as we go around loving and serving others, we're actually serving Jesus. We build our life on these truths. We orientate our lives around these truths. Would you stand with me as we continue to worship? He's worthy for us to live in this way, to lay our life down. And we pray that he would lead us and prompt us and open our eyes to see this week opportunities for us to serve others and love others and build up that treasure.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. You're worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Being holy.
You are holy. There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Well, Lord Jesus, we want to thank you for your word. Thank you for the truths within your word. And Lord, we thank you for the hope of eternity. We thank you, Lord, that you will build a treasure there for us. Thank you for the call on our life to serve and to love. And thank you for your presence with us and in us. And Lord, we pray this week you would open our eyes, move our hearts, help us to treasure those things that you treasure and to love people well. And Lord, thank you, Jesus, for your kingdom. Thank you that you've chosen us to come and to bring your kingdom into this world. Move us, shape us, Lord, we pray. Continue to use us in this world, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. It's been great having you. If you are new to Bridgeman, we'd love to connect with you. There's a Connections Lounge just straight behind me here, in front of me here in the foyer. We'd love to connect with you there. Otherwise, we look forward to seeing you next week. And families, remember, family service 1 week next week in A2 for the families. Thank you so much. We'll see you next week.
Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. All thrones, their dominions, all powers, and positions. Your name is stands above them all. And the angels cry. with every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh Jesus, Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, you are worthy. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, you're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show.